The traditional family is under attack. Are you tired of standing there flat-footed and tongue-tied when your Christian beliefs are attacked? Join me, Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, this June 24th and 25th in Lake Charles, Louisiana, at the Ruth Institute Summit for Survivors of the Sexual Revolution. Join hundreds of other people to get compelling stories, persuasive arguments, and the science to back it all up. Defend your values like a pro. Our website is summitforsurvivors.org.
In this episode of the Ruth Institute Podcast, Dr. Jennifer Morse visits with Father Robert McTeigue on his show, The Catholic Connection. They discuss the meaning of the human body, gender, and the sexual revolution, whether therapy for the same-sex attracted is helpful or harmful, and the absurdity of those who say follow the science. The recurring person that comes to mind is the transgender teenager. Dr. Morse describes feminism as the birth of the LGBT movement because it made sex of the body too insignificant. She explains why we shouldn't use the term conversion therapy and why pharmaceutical companies push transgenderism to teenagers. Short answer, because transgender teenagers will be lifetime buyers of hormone supplements. Be sure to listen to the end to hear Dr. Morse's advice to parents of gender-confused teenagers.
My returning guest today is one of our favorites, always a lively guest. She's going to help us sort it out. She is a writer, president, founder of the Ruth Institute. Dr. Jennifer Morse, welcome back to the Catholic Current.
Thanks for having me on. It's been too long.
Yes, it has. Dr. Morse, the people who yell at us to follow the science regarding, say, wearing masks in response to COVID, and by the way, as of 9 a.m. Eastern time, CDC said the science changed, but not on airplanes.
Yeah, right.
the people tell us to follow the science and tell us men can get pregnant, and the proof of that is the pregnant man emojis. What more proof do you need, you hater? And now we have a cardinal of the church saying that the church's teaching regarding homosexuality needs to be updated. And I thought to myself, well, what else did God reveal or what did we discover in the past week about human bodies that we didn't know before? I'm bewildered. Can you help me out here, please?
Well, no, I'm afraid I can't help you, Father. The real puzzle is how these people continue to get a microphone and why anybody continues to listen to them. That's the real puzzle. I'm as bewildered about that as you are. But no, the claim that people are born gay has some scientific claims embedded in it. Mm-hmm. And if you look closely at it, you find out that those scientific claims have actually been disproven by science. So unfortunately, this cardinal, blessings on his office and blessings on him, of course, but he's just mistaken here to say, his quote was, "This sociological scientific foundation of Catholic teaching on homosexuality is no longer correct," is what he says. And so I'm asking myself, well, what is the science here? What are the questions here? What is it that we supposedly know that we didn't know in St. Augustine's time or whatever? And when you look closely, you find out, well, no, the science actually is consistent with church teaching.
Well, I'm going to pretend I'm a philosophy professor again for a while. It's an old habit of mine. Let's grant the cardinal's premise. Let's just say they did find the gay gene. And that, you know, there really is a genetic predisposition that is absolutely irrevocable. It does not logically follow that homosexual activity is good for you and is good for society. I mean, if I have a predisposition to alcoholism and say I was born that way, hand me the bottle, would you hand me the bottle?
Well, no, you really shouldn't, of course.
Of course not.
And as you say, the predisposition, even if you grant the premise that the predisposition is somehow genetic, which I by no means grant, and
right,
which we'll talk about in a moment, by no means do I grant that proposition. It does not follow that you need to act in a certain way, believe in a certain way, have your political alignments in a certain way. All of those things are, in fact, chosen and can be chosen differently. And we see evidence that people choose differently. So, no, the even if the premise were true, it doesn't follow. And I think it needs to be said, and let's say this early in the conversation, and then we can get back to the science, the strategic importance of the born gay idea is political. Okay, there's a political strategic factor at work here, which is that if you could prove that homosexual practice was somehow an inborn immutable trait, to use the words of the Supreme Court, if that is an immutable trait, then the whole logic of anti-discrimination law can be brought to bear on the subject of how society should treat homosexual practice and homosexual acts and so on and so forth. That's been the strategy all along, to import the whole body of civil rights anti-discrimination law, lock, stock, and barrel, from race to sexual orientation and sexual activity. And if you ask a black person what they think of that, well, they don't think much of it. I'll put it that way. We at the Ruth Institute, we had a whole series of interviews with black pro-life, pro-family leaders for Black History Month in February. You know, we had a whole series of these interviews, and several of them, I asked them this question, and they said, you know, they all said the same thing. Basically, I'm offended by that. I'm offended that you would equate those two things. So
now we have a cardinal of the church. And again, speaking as a theologian, if you pay attention to Revelation and you pay attention to the symbolic import of the church as the bride of Christ, once you begin to bleach out the male, female, once you begin to bleach out, and I'll use a fighting word, heteronormativity, the nature of the church and even the intelligibility of the sacraments begin to break down. In my innocence, I would have thought that a cardinal of the church knew that. Maybe he needs a refresher. So I'm puzzled on that. And if we shift for a moment, the born that way as male and female, that's absolutely fungible. I mean, it's more obvious that you're born male or female than you're born supposedly with same-sex attraction. Why is it that one is set in stone and is immutable, and the other is... We're off to the races. How did we get here?
Well, that's a very interesting question by itself. And it starts, believe it or not, in my mind, it starts with feminism. And when I say feminism, I mean something very specific, because the word feminism means a lot of things to a lot of people. But if you start with the idea that the sex of the body is not particularly important, and that differences between men and women that you observe are socially constructed, and therefore unjust, and therefore can be reconstructed. If you start with that premise, what you're really saying is that the body isn't significant, that the sex of the body isn't significant. And that kind of ideology has been at work through our society for a long time, for my entire adult life. That has been going on. And so, but that premise is incorrect, right? The body is significant. The body is socially significant. How we relate to each other, how we relate to the world is significant. And it becomes intelligible when you look at it theologically, when you say to yourself, well, God made us male and female. What was God trying to say to us when
exactly.
He made us male and female? What is He revealing about the structure of the universe by creating the only rational being that we know of? The only rational corporeal being that we know of. Male and female. Angels, of course, are rational beings, but they don't have bodies. So we're the only rational beings that have bodies, and He made us male and female. Well, this was not a coin toss. He had something in mind here.
Right.
And so for a cardinal of the church to be oblivious to that, you know, that's a big problem. But how we ended up with the particular paradox that you're talking about, that born that way is immutable, but male and female is easily changeable. Both of those have the root, at their root, the idea that the body's not very significant. Because if you say being gay is perfectly normal, and that's part of the, you know, of course, part of the whole ideology, what you're saying is that the reproductive system of the body and the fact that it takes two people to make a baby, and that those two people are different, that none of that is significant. You're disregarding the significance of the body in that very, very important way in which the body actually does matter. Redefining marriage actually was premised on the idea that the body doesn't matter, and that you can have two men, two women, or one of each, and it's no big deal, whatever you do. You know, that's what the Obergefell decision was really telling us. And now you turn around and say, well, the body itself is mutable. So in both cases, you're saying that the body doesn't matter very much. We get to do what we want.
And the irony, of course, is that it's materialists who are saying that, that bodies don't matter. And and certainly I grew up with feminists telling me that biology is not destiny. I've even been told that nature is misogynist, that somehow, you know, female fertility is a bug and not a feature, and it needs to be overcome with science and unshakable, irrevocable acts of the will and of law. And then, of course, there's the classic T-shirt that I saw when I was in college in the 80s with a Dr. Seuss illustration and the words, "A woman needs a man like a fish needs a bicycle." Well, how did that work out for you all? Dr. Morse, I want to talk about therapy for people who experience same-sex attraction and they don't want it. Now, if you want to have people's heads explode, or in certain states, if you want to lose your license as a therapist, if a client says, "I have same-sex attraction, I don't like it, I don't want it, can you help me?" If you say yes, you're in trouble. Why is that?
Well, you see, this goes back with the born gay thing. You know, one of the spin-offs, you could say, of the whole idea that people are born gay is that that's who they really are. That's their authentic identity. And if you try to change their sexual orientation, you will do them harm. That's the equivalent of doing violence to them. And the interesting thing about this, so you'll notice this as a philosophy professor, notice what a strong statement that really is. Say, if you say that it's not possible to change your sexual orientation, that means a single counterexample should be sufficient to refute that claim, right?
Right.
And we have thousands of such counterexamples, right? I mean, I personally know people who are married to opposite sex partners, the people who had lived for a long time in the gay lifestyle and who, you know, lived 20 years married to a person of the opposite sex, right? Now, a single counterexample should be enough to refute the claim that no one can change and that it's harmful to try, right? And so, in effect, what the activists are doing with these laws, and they are all activist-driven, by the way, these laws that ban so-called conversion therapy, we'll talk about that in a minute, too. But the point of the law is to make it harder for people to leave the gay identity and to discourage it, to make it almost unthinkable that if a person's experiencing same-sex attraction, no matter how miserable they may be within their life, that topic is not available for them to discuss with a therapist. The question of their sexual identity and how they may have come to that and what they don't like about that life, those things are off limits. It's something to talk about.
Because science, right?
Because science. But here's the other thing, Father. Listen to this. Every step of the sexual revolution has something like this. So back in the day, years ago, when I had an abortion and I wanted to talk about, and I was depressed, I was upset, I was having night terrors, and I would go to a therapist and I'd say, "Well, maybe this has something to do with the abortion." They would say, "No, couldn't possibly have anything to do with the abortion," you know. The premise being that no woman has ever regretted her abortion. And if you're sorry about the abortion, there was something wrong with you in the first place. That's what you're upset about.
Right.
You were depressed to start with. That's what it was, you know?
Yes.
And so all of these things, and children of divorce, oh my goodness, children get over divorce. They're resilient. They'll be fine. If something's wrong, there's something wrong with your family. It's just you. It's really perfectly normal for children to have their childhoods disrupted, you know? So all of these people who in some way say, "Gee, I tried this out and it didn't work for me," those are precisely the people that you got to shut up. You got to tamp them down. You got to marginalize them. You got to make therapy unavailable to them, right? You got to shut them up because they are a threat to the whole underlying premise here. And you can see it's astonishing how often you see that pattern.
And you know, this is what saddens me, is that there are people who are in distress who do want help. I also think of the heroic people from Courage International, which is a ministry to people with same-sex attraction, that says, no, actually, the church is right. Everyone must right. live chastely according to their state in life, and everyone with God's grace and some common sense really can. And there are people who bravely carried a cross for many years and have grown in sanctity. If the ideology we're addressing is correct, all these people were suckers. They could have just right. given up and become libertine and lived happily ever after. I mean, the ideologues that we meet, what would they say to people from Courage International who are trying to seek God's wisdom about leading chaste lives? Would they say, fools, cut it out?
They ridicule them. Yeah. Oh, yeah. They ridicule them. At best, they ridicule them. At worst, they, I don't know that they're trying to silence Courage, but perhaps, I mean, and this is one of the problems with these bans on therapy, is that they're written in such a broad manner that the kind of peer counseling, counselors are afraid to just talk to somebody, you know, and maybe peer counseling, maybe reading Bible verses, maybe that all counts as so-called conversion therapy. And we should talk about the terminology for a minute, too. The term conversion therapy is something that was invented by the opponents of sexual orientation change to smear it, okay? And it's meant to convey the idea that some snake-handling religious figure takes you off in the woods and lays hands on you and does
something
to
pray the gay away. Yes.
And you pray the gay away. That's right. And then, so they always use the term, the ideologues or the activists will always use the term conversion therapy. Now, the people who study this in a serious, systematic manner refer to it as sexual orientation change efforts. Okay? Sexual orientation change efforts. Now, the reason that's important is because it's taking a modest and clear view of what's going on. They're making an effort to change sexual orientation. We know that in most therapeutic environments, change is not 100% guaranteed. So if you go in with the problem of anxiety or the problem of depression or, you know, any of a number of psychological issues that you might go to a therapist for, there's no guarantee that you're going to be successful in that change, right? But it doesn't mean that it's harmful. It doesn't mean you shouldn't try. And so on, right? We understand, generally speaking, we understand that. It's only in this area of sexual orientation change efforts that we say even the effort itself is harmful, because the effort undermines your identity as a gay person. And that's really what's at stake here, is do you buy that this is an identity?
You see, this is part of what confuses me, and if I'm confused, I wonder what's happening among our children as well. That if we're really advocates for the health of children, because this is where I think the battle is.
Yes.
If we're really concerned about the health of children, I think it's really pernicious to tell children they can't trust common sense, they can't trust the record of ordinary human experience, and they can't trust their own senses. You know, when you tell a child, you know, you can look down and learn a lot about who you are in that moment. No, you can't. You need me to tell you. Then when we add and we see this in schools, you know, don't tell your parents. You know, when an adult tells a child, this is going to be our secret, isn't that grooming behavior?
Yep, that's exactly what it is. It's grooming behavior. And that's your big screaming red flag that something is going on that shouldn't be going on. And parents, thankfully, one of the good things that has come out of the whole COVID situation is that a lot of parents for the first time are finding out what their kids are being taught at school. Right. And some of those parents are hopping mad about it and fighting back.
Right. I know that in California, I don't know, I think this has been signed into law. I'm not 100% certain, but I think the regulations are something along these lines. If a child is receiving sensitive medical services that's going to be paid for by insurance, and that includes contraception, abortion, and transgender efforts, including hormones and surgery, the insurance company is to pay for it, and the parents are not to be informed.
Yeah. And that, I'm glad you brought that up, because that has its roots in the whole contraceptive ideology. Okay. In other words, the idea that parents don't need to know what's going on with their children's so-called sexual health, that has been part of Medicaid standards for quite a while, actually, Father. Mm-hmm. You know, parents have been discovering that their children have been taken off to receive an abortion, and that they didn't know about it until it was way after the fact. That's been part of law. That's been part of social practice. That's been there for a while. So that's why I say, you know, the whole transgender moment that we're dealing with now, it didn't arise out of nowhere. It didn't just right. pop out of nowhere. It's been, the ground has been plowed and laid for that for really quite a while.
Right. And I'm very skeptical of some of the so-called advocates of children. I mean, it's an open secret that if an adult male shows up with a minor female at a Planned Parenthood clinic and asks for an abortion, that's prima facie evidence of statutory rape. They're mandated reporters. They're supposed to call the authorities and let the authorities sort that out. Time and time again, that didn't happen. I remember years ago, Life Dynamics Institute had an actress call every Planned Parenthood clinic in the United States claiming to be a 14-year-old girl whose 30-year-old boyfriend got her pregnant. And in the vast majority of cases, the Planned Parenthood representative on the other end of the line said, "It's okay, we'll keep it on the down low." That's a crime.
Yeah, that's right.
That's a crime.
That's right. And it's a crime. It's a crime that's never been prosecuted. And that kind of thing, Father, is why I talk about the sexual state. I mean, that's the sexual state at work right there. That's what I'm talking about. Without the power of the state to look the other way at what would have otherwise been a crime, it's clear that Planned Parenthood has them eating out of their hand. You know,
yes.
that the ideology that says, you know, here is the meaning of human sexuality. Here is the purpose of sexuality in our lives. Here's the meaning of your body. There is a ideology afoot that is in direct contradiction to Christianity, and the state is on the side of that ideology. And that's what we're up against.
And right.
that's,
and
you know, that, yeah. Go ahead.
No, I was going to say that, and this is why these people who exhort us to follow the science, for the most part, I really don't want to hear from them. We already have the state medical organizations saying, well, we don't want to put male or female on birth certificates. I said, you studied physiology. You've studied biology.
Yep.
You've studied genetics. You know, I was in a Zoom meeting and I was horrified that people should know better were announcing their pronouns. Someone had an idea, I wish I had thought of it myself, where this fellow put on his pronoun identification on Zoom is, my chromosomes are XY. And suffice to say, people were very unhappy with that statement of fact. Dr. Morse, at the beginning of the show, we said that I was born that way, having to do with same-sex attraction is supposed to be the mic drop, the show stopper, but when it comes to sexual identity as male or female, that's just the point of departure. There are even state medical organizations that don't want to record male or female on birth certificates. Why is transgenderism gaining so much momentum? It seems to be everywhere. There are more people than I can count calling and say, Father, my niece, my grandson, my sister-in-law just made a big announcement at Thanksgiving dinner or at Christmas. Have people been experiencing gender dysphoria all this time and only now people are speaking about it? What do you think is going on?
I think there are a number of things going on. I mean, first of all, the idea that the body is significant is itself being challenged. Okay, and so people, when you destabilize something as basic as that, are you a boy or are you a girl? Are you a man or are you a woman? When you destabilize something that is as basic to your identity as that, then people have to construct their own identity, and that new identity is being ready delivered to them, which is the trans identity or gender fluid identity or something like that. And if you think about it, that to be a man or to be a woman is to have a body and also to live in that body and to live in that body in a particular cultural and social context. And it's simply a fact that it has become harder to know what to do as a man, to know what to do as a woman, you know, and that's part of the legacy of feminism. Men don't know whether to hold the door for the woman and be polite to her or what, or just to barge through and be rude. You know, what am I supposed to do as a man? What am I supposed to do as a woman? Wait a minute, I don't want to put my baby in daycare. I want to be with my baby. Is there something wrong with me because I want to stay home with my baby? You know, that kind of thing. It's become increasingly difficult. And so if you take those things together, the increasing difficulty of knowing what it means to be a man or a woman, add to it the immense amount of propaganda that is out in the culture now. And there is just a lot of room for people to be confused. And they're stepping right into that door of confusion.
I've talked to some experts in the field and pediatricians and so on. And the pediatricians I spoke with said a basic rule of thumb for pediatric care is go slow. You know, you wait, you know, you investigate, you see if there are changes over time. But it seems that if Sally wants to be Sammy or Jimmy wants to be Jane, we have to rip out the prescription pad immediately. We got to chemically carpet bomb puberty and we got to schedule surgery. Because why? What's the rationale for that rush?
Well, I can tell you the stated rationale. The stated rationale is that they're going to commit suicide if you don't do what they say. And this, to me, is one of the most insidious things that is going on in our culture right now, of basically browbeating parents with this kind of emotional blackmail, number one. And number two, coaching kids on how to say that and what to say so that they can get their pills or their hormones or their shots or whatever it is they want. We know that this is going on. You know, there are internet chat rooms where this type of stuff is going on. And there are clubs at schools where this kind of stuff is going on. So you have to ask yourself, who's pumping this stuff? Who's pushing this stuff? And why? What do they want? You know, and we do know that among the big contributors to the gender ideology are pharmaceutical companies or foundations that have close ties with pharmaceutical companies. The gender clinics that are popping up around the country and that needs, you know, that need patients, that need somebody to go to them, right? Those have been funded by this type of foundation or these type of individuals who have strong ties to the pharmaceutical companies. Now, think about that. You know, if you're going to convince somebody that you're really born in the wrong body, and what you need is sexual reassignment surgery, that person is going to be a customer for hormones for the rest of their life. Okay,
right.
That is a lifetime customer for hormones. And if you can get the government to pay for it, all the better, which is, you know, that's
your tax dollars at work.
This is what the insurance companies, the regulation of the insurance companies, you know, that's not all the insurance companies doing. It's not like they're all sitting down and saying, oh, gosh, we should really do something for the poor trans people. You know, it's in many cases, in many states, it has to do with the insurance regulation. There are a lot of steps to this process, but to find somebody who's truly disinterested and who's truly looking at children and the good of children and looking at children the way we always used to look at children, which is that they're helpless and dependent and in need of protection and guidance. We don't look at children like that anymore, you know, and that, too, is part of the legacy of the sexual revolution and the sexual state, I would say. But once you go down that path, boy, it's really hard to retrace your steps.
What we have is children being treated as customers and as consumers,
yep,
of a libertine sexual ethic, and you're getting people onto the, if you will, the on ramp of addiction and confusion that can't be good for people. And again, we just a very simple thing, you know, Sally is thinking about becoming Sammy, takes testosterone for 6 months, changes her mind, thanks be to God, but her voice has changed forever.
Yes. Yeah.
Does anyone tell
that's
her
one
that
of the
in
most,
advance?
That's one of the most heartbreaking things that we hear from parents, you know, that my daughter's voice is gone. I'll never hear that voice again, ever.
Right.
You know, yeah. It's really it is heartbreaking. And no, they're not telling people this stuff. They're not revealing this stuff. But you know, again, a lot of this stuff has had a long on ramp. The idea of sexual education, telling children that they can be a boy or a girl or whatever they want. Hey, sex ed has been in the school for a long time. Sex ed for a long time has been grooming children for sexual activity. Rather than protecting their innocence, it has been telling them how they can have sex without having babies, you know?
Right.
And that's supposed to be safe. That's supposed to be good for them, you know? And that's why in my book, The Sexual State, I have a 15-point manifesto for the family at the end of the book. And the very first item on that manifesto is abolish sex ed, because it is nothing but propaganda. It is propaganda for the sexual revolution. And there is no way in on this earth that public schools should be using taxpayer dollars to teach that to everybody's children. That's crazy.
Right.
And it shows that what we're dealing with here is not some kind of social, cultural, amorphous change. No, we're dealing with a top-down, elite-driven ideology being driven for reasons best known to themselves, although we can guess as to what some of their motives are.
Right. But
we now know that there is a global oligarchy. We know that we didn't know that necessarily 2 years ago, but now we know that that's true, and we know what they're capable of.
Yes,
and
indeed,
this is part of what they're capable of.
As someone who's taught medical ethics for 25 years, and I've had to read a lot of things I wish I could forget, including sex ed curricula and so on. I was texting a close friend the other day. I said, "Hey, what are you up to?" He says, "Well, I'm signing exemption forms for my daughters to not be in the school's HIV prevention program." And I said, "Your daughters are 11 and 13. And then I thought of a book, which is, you'd be glad to know, the new revised and updated 2021 edition of a book called It's Perfectly Normal. The last time I looked at it, you can copulate in any imaginable arrangement with any imaginable number you want, as long as there's consent.
Mm-hmm.
And then the inconveniences of diseases or pregnancies can be magicked away by precaution. Now, of course, that's demonstrably false. And we both know that even if it were absolutely true, it says nothing about broken hearts or stunting people's ability to make commitments as well. Let's add to that. So we've got that in the schools. And then we've got to add to it. Hey, you know what we should do? We should get preschoolers together for story hour in the library and have drag queens who haven't gone through criminal background checks.
Present
to, you know, I mean, I've seen videos where the drag queen is teaching the kids to sing the hips on the queen go swish, swish, swish all around the town. Have people, has there been something put in the water, or is the Joker or some Batman villain giving some kind of hidden gas to parents that say, that's a great idea, I want my kids around that sex offender, because some of these guys later on turns out were sex offenders. What is going on?
Well, see, the point is that no sane parent really does want that. And so the blessing, I guess you could say, of transgenderism coming at us so rapidly is that people can see for themselves that this is a top-down phenomenon, okay? That there is an on-ramp to it, but there is no grassroots support for transgenderism. It is all astroturf. It is all made up, all being promoted, tons of propaganda is being pushed at us. Everybody can see that now, okay? And so if you take that thought and work it backwards, you see the whole sexual revolution was like that. There was no big outcry for abortion. There was no big outcry for no-fault divorce. None of that. It was all constructed by elites to change the whole social sexual system that we operate in. And what they want, you came very close to articulating it, and let me put it out there just precisely. What they want is a world where you can have sex, anything, you can do anything you want sexually, and nothing bad will happen to you or anyone around you as long as you have consent and condoms. You'll be fine.
Right.
And that is a lie from top to bottom. It's just, it's so untrue. And it doesn't take that much to figure out that it's not true. Most people listening to this program have had experiences, direct experiences, that would tell them it's not true. And so therefore you have to propagandize people further to keep them from figuring it out. And that's what we're dealing with. That's why the propaganda never stops. It literally never stops because it can't stop, Father. Look, this is a totalitarian ideology. It's yes. totalitarian in that it has global ambitions and it has global interior ambitions. They want to get into your head. They care about your thoughts. They care yes. about how you think of yourself, how you think about the world around you. And they are totalitarian in the classic sense that it's for world domination. I just read today, literally just today, in the Dominican Republic, the government of the Dominican Republic is being pressured to allow abortion and to add anti-discrimination statutes to their law to protect LGBT people, supposedly, or people are not going to be able to get visas to the United States. The United States government is pressuring sovereign states to change their laws around this. Okay? And that's been going on for decades.
Yes, it
I
has.
I promise you. Decades.
No, it's certainly. I mean, going back to the Kennedy administration, too bad about that earthquake. We'll help you out. Sign here. Your tax dollars at work. No, I agree with you. There is a deliberate choice to brainwash people into the illusion that you can have sex without consequence. And that's demonstrably false. We've always known that. Dr. Morse, I want to give parents hope. I'm sure some of them are grinding their teeth. But I think of friends whose oldest child is going to high school in the fall. I have several friends who are expecting the birth of their first child this year. I have a friend whose little girl is going to turn two on Saturday. There's going to be a party with pink balloons and teddy bears. I don't want them to listen to this show and say, oh my gosh, I have to dig a bunker right now. At the end of your book, The Sexual State, you talk about a manifesto for families. Can you give guidance and action items for parents and families to keep their kids healthy and safe and sane?
Well, before I do that, I want to return to the very first thing that you brought me on the show to talk about, which is this poor Catholic cardinal who talked about how church teaching is out of date scientifically. What I want to say to you is that science actually supports traditional Christian sexual ethics.
Yes.
Whether it's the physical sciences, medical science, whether it's the social sciences. And that's what we do all day long at the Ruth Institute, is to try to collect that information and have it all in one place so you can find it when you need it, you know.
Right.
So I want you to have hope in that sense. I absolutely think people can be hopeful and need to be hopeful, because if you don't have hope, you know, we kind of fall apart.
Right.
If we don't see a way clear, you know, to victory of some sort or another. Mm-hmm. So I just want people to be assured that the church's teaching has not been disproven by science in any way, shape, or form, okay? Mm-hmm. So that's the first thing. Now, the second thing I would say, now, the manifesto for the family that I gave Father is a public policy type of thing, okay? In other words, it's 15 public policies of things that need to be done. And the first 10 are things that the government should stop doing that it never had any business doing. So you can look at that list, and if you have a libertarian friend who says, well, we got to get the government out of this business, imposing your values, you know, you hear that kind of stuff.
Oh,
and
yes.
I think we all have friends who talk like that from time to time, right?
Mm-hmm.
on the left and on the right, you have people talking like that from time to time. But the point is, if you're telling the government to stop doing something, that's not an imposition anymore now, is it? You know,
right.
it's a recognition that they've been imposing on you all along. And so there's that. But from the perspective of a particular family, you know, what you should do as individual parents and so on, is that what you want to talk about, or do you want to talk about that public policy list?
Let's talk about advice for parents. Because, I mean, if I were a parent of a young child, I'd be looking for an island somewhere at this
yeah.
point, and I don't know, and I don't want to move people to despair. I really don't want to be
yes.
an alarmist.
Yes. Well, you don't want to be an alarmist, but you also don't want to be naive, okay?
Right.
You're dealing with something very serious here, okay? And I think people are aware of that. And I think it is important to do whatever you can to protect your children from what's going on in the culture. And so, therefore, some part of the family and all of us at some state in life do need to be engaged with school board conversations and
yes.
conversations with your Catholic school principal and things like that. You know, I get it. When you've got five small children at home underfoot, You don't have time or energy to go pick it at the library.
Right.
You might, but if you don't, no one would think badly of you. But your husband maybe should be doing that, and your mom and dad maybe should be doing that. Grandma and grandpa, you know, get off the golf course and get off the couch, stop going shopping, and, you know, go attend to these things, because your kids are preoccupied with trying to deal with the day-to-day business of the family. And you, as the grandparent or the maiden aunt, as we used to say, or the unmarried uncle or whatever it is, you can be engaged politically, and somebody needs to do that, and it's very
yes.
important. As to individual parents, what you should do, the first thing you need to understand, and if you have a child or a young friend who's talking in a gender dysphoria language, you know, the first thing you can say to them is, no one is born in the wrong body.
Right.
No one is born in the wrong body. That is a fact, okay? And the second thing that I would say to a child in this situation is, there are lots of ways to be a boy. There are lots of ways to be a girl. The fact that you don't like gender-typical things, that, you know, you're interested in the arts and not in sports, that doesn't mean that you're not a boy. You're a boy. Girls, if you like to play baseball, if you like to climb trees, that doesn't mean that you're really a boy. There are lots of ways to be a boy. There are lots of ways to be a girl.
Right.
And that's where I would spend my focus. And for the love of God, keep them out of the gender clinics.
Yes, absolutely.
You've got to stay out of the gender clinics. You know, that's hopeless right there.
Right. Right. No, I'm in full agreement with you there. I also believe that, you know, we talk about, you know, we teach kids about stranger danger, who we let yeah. into our home, not only through the front door, but through electronic media. And we can have a whole long conversation mm-hmm. about children and electronic devices and so on. But isn't it also useful and desirable to have your children be around happy, healthy people?
Oh, you know, gosh, yes.
You
yeah,
know,
absolutely.
To say that, you know, mom and dad yeah. have friends who are adults, who are married, and they raise their children like mom and dad raise our kids, and these people go to church like mom and dad take us. Talk about the importance of friendship for the sake of family.
You know, that's really a good point, and I like the way you put it there at the end, you know, that friendship for the sake of family is very important, and it can be very uplifting. I have heard different versions of this story from various people, whether they were the adults or the child, you know. I have heard people say, my family life was a mess, but we had a neighbor who had
yeah.
a stable family life. And I liked going over there. I liked being part of that.
Mm-hmm.
And I wished for that. But whatever was going on with my mom and dad, I liked being over there and liked being part of that. And that gave me hope. And mm-hmm. and I have heard of adult friends say to me that, you know, a child later told them, you know, years later told them how much it meant to them to go over to their house and be part of their family life and see a functioning family, a functional family that had problems but would solve the problems and not everybody scattered just because somebody got their feelings hurt, you know. All of those type of problem-solving skills that you really need. Everybody needs problem-solving skills. You know, you don't
sure.
have it for the ills every time you have a problem, you know. But that's what often children of divorce or children of broken families, they internalize that idea, you know, that, oh, there's something wrong here. I guess we're going to get divorced. You know what I mean? They don't have any template for working through those kinds of problems. So that's a very important gift that you give your children is to be embedded within a network of families that are stable and taking care of each other and so on. That's a very important aspect.
Right. And you know, I'm in full agreement with that. And please, God, I really, speaking as a Catholic priest, I hope that families can find those kinds of families in their local parishes and in their parochial schools.
Yeah.
I also think looking in your local homeschool network is essential. Dr. Jennifer Morse of the Ruth Institute, God bless your good work. Thank you for being a delightful conversation partner. Look forward to next time.
Thanks so much for having me, Father. I look forward to it, too.
Does transgenderism and the gay takeover of public schools appall you? get the tools to fight for your family and the well-being of all children at the Summit for Survivors of the Sexual Revolution this June 24th and 25th in Lake Charles, Louisiana. Hear expert testimony from those who left the gay and transgender lifestyles. Visit summitforsurvivors.org for more details.